morning. Welcome to Chalice Unitarian Universalist Congregation. We are a community of diverse beliefs and experiences, nurturing the liberal religious spirit and united by our desire to grow in love and in service. Whoever you are, whomever you love, whatever your life's journey, you are welcome here. Whether you gather with us every Sunday, once or twice a year, or are with us this morning for the first time, we are glad you are here. I'm Reverend Sharon Wiley, Chalice's minister. Our worship musician this morning is our music director, Tim McKnight, and our song leader is Amy Throckmorton. Welcome to this online worship service. Let me orient you if you are a new visitor with us. Whether you have a microphone at your computer or a camera at your computer, you cannot unmute yourself and you cannot make yourself visible. So you do not need to worry that anyone can hear what you're saying or see what you are doing wherever you are. I hope you're comfortable and have a nice morning beverage this morning. If you get a notice that pops up during the service that says internet unstable, that means that your internet is unstable. If you have other devices in your home that are using Wi-Fi, you might want to put those on airplane mode or turn them off to help stabilize your connection. If my internet becomes unstable, or if Zoom crashes or has problems, those are the things that could disrupt our worship. And that's just how it is. So if something like that happens, try not to be too stressed. Just sit tight for a while. If you were to be kicked out of the webinar, come back in, just hang tight and we'll see if we can get back on track. So this is me standing at the doorway to our chapel, standing on our courtyard, greeting you as you arrive on Sunday morning. Since I can't hug you myself, I'm going to ask that you give yourselves a big hug of hello. And if you share space with someone else, you might give that person a hug to a way of saying good morning. So on your menu is a button that says chat. Chat is where we talk to each other during the service. There are people saying hello already. I'm going to put in the chat a link to our online connection card. There it is. So if you are new to the congregation and would like to receive our email announcements, you can fill out that online connection card and that's how you get onto our email list. We have many more meetings and activities happening through the week on Zoom, and you need to be on our email list to get most of that information. Also, if you're a regular attendee at Chalice, one of our members or friends, and if you have a question you would normally submit or a change of address or any change in contact information, you can also use that online connection card just like you would have when we did in-person connection cards. I'm also going to put into the chat my email address. If you would like to submit a prayer request to me or have any confidential information you'd like me to know, those are things you can email me and I'll read them privately after the service. So some of our congregants love to use chat and we encourage you to use chat during this service, but not everyone likes it. So if you don't like chat and find it distracting, you can close the chat box so you don't see it. In the same way how we close and open the chat box is the same, where there's on your Zoom menu where it says chat and your menu is I think probably at the bottom of your screen for most of you, your Zoom screen. You can just click on chat and it should close the box if it's open, and if it's closed, pressing chat will open it. So that's how you control that. So for those of us who are using chat, you want to make sure when you post, there's a little blue drop-down menu in the chat, and you want to make sure that it says all panelists and attendees. I'm the only panelist, so if you only post to panelists, I'm the only one who sees it, and I probably am not going to see it during the service or realize that I'm the only one who saw it. So we want to be talking to each other as a group, so you'll use all panelists and attendees. So now we'll use the chat box to go ahead and keep saying hello to each other. If you're a first-time visitor and are comfortable sharing that, we'd be happy to know. And also let us know where around the county or the country you are this morning, because we do have folks all over the place. So we'll take some time for chat and we'll listen to some music. Congregational meeting is today after the service, so we invited our current congregational president and vice president, Alec Bergamini and Dean Gaudet. They're just about to become the past president and the current president. We invited them to light our chalice this morning. Today is the 10th in a 10-part worship series on cultivating resiliency in an age of overwhelm. Our call to worship. Everything is in turmoil, shifting, opening, people on the streets marching, demanding, new ways of being, new systems of accountability, true justice, everything like compost, turning, transforming, everything broken and failing, now exposed, visible for all to see. Our world rich with disintegration and possibility. Transformation is not easy. Now is when we gather for rest. Now is when we gather for reflection. This hour, a germination, a time for new life to take hold of us so that we too are made new, like the world. We too are turned and transformed, nourished by song and story and music and ideas. Let us worship together. Please join in singing.
There is more love somewhere. There is more love somewhere. I'm gonna keep on till I find it. There is more love somewhere.
Now is the time for our sharing of sorrows. We'll share these in the chat box. These won't be spoken out loud, but please feel free to respond to each other in the chat. This is the time for sorrows. We'll share joys a bit later in the service, and we'll listen to some piano music. And if you have a candle in your home that you would like to light for sorrows, now is the time. Thank you. May our sorrows be lessened. May our burdens be lightened. In sorrow and challenge, may we know ourselves always held and never alone. May we act to extend our warmth to all who are hurting in our wider world. George Floyd died almost 2 weeks ago. And since then, people have protested every day. There have been protests across the country, in large cities and small towns, suburban neighborhoods, and state capitals. There have been protests in countries around the world. In bringing our sermon series to a close, I have thoughts to share with you later in the service, but I wanted to give the bulk of our time to the perspective of an African American Unitarian Universalist, as seems only right at this particular historical moment. Our pulpit guest this morning is Reverend Karen Hutt, affiliated minister at the First Universalist Church of Minneapolis. This sermon was preached for that congregation last Sunday. It is called No Justice, No Peace. A word of warning, in sharing some history, there are descriptions of violence in this sermon and use of the N-word. And a technical note, this is a recording and the visual is out of sync with the audio. So try not to be distracted by that. And just know that the audio is fine. So if the visual bothers you, please focus on listening.
My name is Karen Hutt. I am a minister with First Universalist, and I have never been so proud to be a UU. It's been 25 years this year for me in ministry, and I am grateful to be with all of you. I was born with a heart defect. Doctors were uncertain if they could do such a risky surgery, and a very costly surgery on this little colored girl in 1959. They debated, my parents challenged the hospital, and 2 years later, my life was saved through the surgery. But following my surgery, it was in a largely African-American hospital. They moved that procedure out of the city, making it really inaccessible for Black families. There's no justice. There's no peace. When I was a kid, my great-grandfather, who was born just after the Emancipation Proclamation, told me about his mother, who had been enslaved. His mom was a seamstress who freed herself. She needed work, and she got a job sewing Confederate flags during the Civil War. She used the money to buy her relatives out of slavery. Her husband, though, we learned very little about, was murdered by white children for fun. The story goes that they took out his eyeballs for marbles. There's no justice. There's no peace. When I was a kid, my grandfather told me about how proud he was to be a soldier during World War I. He loved the uniform because the women in France thought that he was just the most handsome Negro ever. When he and his best friends came home from the war to Delaware, Maryland area, they were chased by a gang of white men. They caught my pup-pup's friend and lynched him. The pup-pup hid in some debris until it was safe to escape. At the lynching, hundreds of white adults and children took pictures with his friend's charred body, smiling. And then chunks of his body was distributed to the many that sought them to put in what was called a nigger jar. There was no justice. There was no peace. When I was a teenager, I was a popular, mischievous, smart aleck kid who took lots of risks with the boys. We sat on the chains between the subway cars in Philadelphia, sitting on them while the train was moving 80 miles an hour underground. We jumped on the back of public city buses and held onto the ledge to ride to the next stop. We asked adults to buy us Boone's Farm apple wine at the state store. And the cops would always come on these incidents, and I couldn't run very fast, so I always hid underneath the cars. All the boys were eventually arrested or beaten, at least once by the police in their early years, and many, many, many went to juvie. There is no justice. There is no peace. When I was a young adult, I took a boat to work on an island in the Boston Harbor with black and white kids from South Boston High School. We were teaching them leadership skills using the ropes course and environmental science as a metaphor so they could go back into their school during the height of racial violence during the busing crisis in Boston in the early 80s. One day I had to take the late boat back to Dorchester Bay and walk a mile to the Red Line train station. On the way, I was jumped by a gang of whites. I was left semi-conscious on the ground after a brief but painful encounter. There's no justice and there's no peace. When I was 30, in my 30s, I moved to Chicago, the most segregated city in America. One day I was driving and was pulled over by the police. But a matter of 15 times in 1 year. I was ticketed, harassed, disrespected. There's no justice. There's no peace. When I was in my 40s, I worked at a maximum security prison with thousands of black men, piled like sardines, 7 floors high. I watched guards step on the heads of these men and then drag them down concrete staircases in races on either side of the tier for entertainment. There was no justice and there was no peace. Now, in my 60s, I see my country much the way I see this so-called president, both behaving like insolent children, a ravenous toddler, unable and uninterested in controlling or mitigating raw historical racist impulses to conquer and destroy black life. These eruptions against our humanity can happen at any time and at any place because anti-blackness and white supremacy are the bedrock of this nation. The slightest tremor can shake the ground beneath our feet. And then that foot of gleeful control steps on our collective necks. This country who hears my pain as white noise, who sees my blood as inconvenient puddles to step over. This country has weathered my black body with stress and illness. This country whose structures and machinery of injustice continue to create new ways to separate my head from my body. You see, America loves our black bodies. To throw a ball on a field, to dunk a hoop, to labor in the industries of capital for sexual fantasies and the provision of entertainment. But our black heads, not so much. Our heads that create black towns after slavery, our heads that innovate and invent, our heads that do complex math, our heads that write novels, our heads who create music and smile and joke with generativity despite the terror, our heads that have figured out how to survive and how to take care of ourselves, our dignified heads that are held high, and most of all, our heads that speak truth to power. For the American anti-black movement, it is that head of George Floyd, his head with kinky hair, his head with a broad African nose, his head with beautiful full lips, his head with dark brown skin. It is that head that the anti-black agenda seeks to sever from its body. So white supremacy can feed. You must cut off that head so it can feed on him like zombies feed on brains. The killer cop that kneeled on George Floyd's neck lingered with childish glee. Look at his face. And he's lingering with institutional sanction, thinking that this was okay, that this was acceptable to do. He looks bewildered at all the fuss as he casually keeps his hand in his pocket, just passing the time on a black man's neck. After all, George was not human. You cannot hear the pleas of a non-human. You cannot respond to the life being sucked out of a non-human. You can kill him to obliterate breathing blackness, speaking blackness, thinking blackness. The machine of white supremacy is so well oiled, not to see or to hear or to feel. It is a cold and calculating gadget with one singular laser-focused objective: to kill me in the most comprehensive and thorough manner. Slowly through policy and infrastructure, or suddenly through the deprivation of oxygen. This machine, with its intricate screws ground into my ancestral body, this machine that has robbed black people of our liberty and who profited by this theft every hour that we live, have no moral ground on which to stand. It is the humiliated, incarcerated, mutilated, and terrorized black body that serves as the vestibule for this democratic republic. I love this country. And all my life, I have heard that it's going to take time for America to change. I believed it, and I worked for it. But I have a message to my own childish aspirations today from the Me Too movement. And that message is, time's up. How much time does it take to see us as human? How much time does it take for our pleas to be heard? You know, there's a great relief in saying time's up. It means that something else is going to happen. It means an end of something. It means now what? What it doesn't mean is hope for something better. It means actions for something better. We are witnessing a shocking accumulation of injured and mutilated black bodies, particularly young black bodies. Our Unitarian, Universalist, liberal, and progressive white communities need to ask themselves this question. If our movement is truly progressing towards this, quote, society that is to come, maybe, if we're really moving towards that, why is suffering increasing at such an alarming rate? In response to this inquiry, are you telling your black siblings that they remain hopeful? Keep struggling? Keep hope alive? Keep faith? I have come to the conclusion that hope is a deadly aspiration for black people. When we hope, we are still. Hope is a naive conundrum that doesn't inspire action. Being hopeful comes from a place of lack and scarcity. Hope causes us to wait for things to happen to us rather than going out and creating those things for ourselves. While we hope, we continue to suffer. America depends on black people to wait and hope and pray so white supremacy can continue maintaining and adding to our suffering. My great-grandfather hoped, and he and my family taught me during the uprisings in 1968 that the political arithmetic of this country wants us to hope while it's saturated with violence. It was founded on looting in the Boston Harbor. It looted the land of the native folks. It looted the shores of Africa that brought me here. It looted the environment. It looted black communities from their wealth, Thus, nonviolence is a misnomer or somewhat of a ruse. Hope is a Black sacrifice. It is a violence directed towards the self, and it is useless. Political hope has usurped the spiritual principle of hope and puts it in the service of extending oppression. The political hope is bound up with metaphysical violence. And this violence masquerades as a solution to the problem of anti-Blackness. This hopeful, temporal, linear perfection is connected to the tropes of betterment, struggle, work, and utopian multicultural futures. These conceptual instruments of political hope will never obviate Black suffering or anti-Black violence. These concepts only serve to reproduce the conditions that render our existence unbearable. Political theologians and optimists avoid the immediacy of Black suffering, the horror of anti-Black pulverization, and paint pictures of the, quote, not yet but is, maybe to come soon, maybe the social order will be. Political hope becomes a vicious and abusive cycle of struggle. It is like, putting a circle around an idea or an object. The idea might be Black freedom. It might be reparations. It might be justice or relief or reprieve or redress or equality. Putting a circle around it and then making it inaccessible because it doesn't really exist. Those with political hope propose a collective enjoyment as an answer to Black suffering. They point to finding the joy in the struggle, the victory in the toil, and the satisfaction of symbolic action and the singing of songs from enslavement. How repulsive is it that in our very own hymnal, there is a song, "No More Auction Block for Me," white you use singing about toil and struggle as Black youth are slaughtered daily. Black bodies are incarcerated as forms of capital. Black infant mortality rates are soaring, and hunger is disabling the bodies, minds, and spirits of desperate Black youth. These conditions are deep problems, and singing spirituals does not address the terrifying fact that the world depends on Black death to sustain white life. They depended on my ancestors' death, but I'm here to say time's up again. I'm here to say it for Richard Johnson, my great-grandfather, who said at the end of slavery, the end of slavery was just a coffee break. And he went on to create numerous Black businesses, employed much of his community in good jobs. Time's up for Walter Grooms, my pup-pup, who, like other Black soldiers, was a war runner across the battlefield, who took messages from one battalion to another across explosive areas. He came home to be a union organizer at the Navy Yard. Time's up for Shirley Grooms, my mother, a social worker, and George Hutt, my father, an engineer and politician, who risked everything. They risked everything walking me one day across a racial barrier to enroll me into an all-white school that had the resources they believed I need for my education. My ancestors did not hope and wait. They acted and organized. Friends, go now and try for a day. See what it's like to let go of political hope. Just let it go. Imagine the creation of a spiritual, human, life-centered, life-giving hope that's rooted in the reality of the world we have now, not the one we dream of. Imagine the creation of a spiritual, human, life-centered, life-giving hope that will be built with the Black and white ashes that have been left on Lake Street. Imagine. Blessed be. Amen and Ashe.
Let's join in singing. shared our sorrows earlier in the service, and now it's time to share joys. If you have a joy you would like to share with the community this morning, you can share it in the chat box. We won't share these out loud, but feel free to respond to each other in the chat. If you have a candle at home that you would like to light for joy, this is the time, and we'll listen to music. Joys be multiplied. May we act to extend our warmth to all who are rejoicing in the wider world. The Sunday offering is an expression of the generosity that makes our congregational life possible. As Buddhist teacher Sharon Salzberg writes, generosity is characterized by the inner quality of letting go or relinquishing. being able to let go, to give up, to renounce, to give generously. These capacities spring from the same source within us. When we practice generosity, we open to all of these liberating qualities simultaneously. You are invited to text your donation to Chalice. If you haven't texted a donation before, know that once you text the numbers, the amount, you'll get a reply with a link to follow to enter your credit card information. And once you've done that once, you won't need to enter it again. If your Sunday donation is part of your pledge payment, please be sure to indicate pledge after the dollar amount. You can type in those words. You'll see an example on the screen that's about to come up. You can make a text donation anytime. You don't need to do it during worship. The phone number will be on the screen, and I'll put it in the chat box also. Please give generously. Please join in dedicating our offering with words of affirmation. When all the people of the world love, then the strong will not overpower the weak, the many will not oppress the few, the wealthy will not mock the poor, the honored will not disdain the humble, the cunning will not deceive the innocent. This will be our world when all the people love.
Thank you.
Each year for the past 5 years, I've selected a topic for a 10-part sermon series called our Spirit Study topic. This year's topic has been cultivating resiliency in an age of overwhelm. And when we started last September, I thought the things we were overwhelmed by were political news and social media and things like that. 10 months later, I'm amazed and chagrined. We were so innocent back in September, weren't we? We thought we were overwhelmed then. Adorable. Living through a pandemic, we are learning, changes everything. It seemed overwhelming at the beginning as we were suddenly required to stay home and change how we do everything. And now, as things are starting to open up, we're finding a new level of stress and anxiety because now we have choices and those choices are stressful. How much risk are you willing to take for a haircut? How much risk are you willing to take to go have dinner at a restaurant? We may have disagreements with our family and friends about what's safe and what's not, what we want to do and what we refuse to do. It turns out staying at home may have been the easy part for many of us anyway. And now, suddenly, after years and years of social justice work, the Black Lives Matter movement has somehow both exploded and coalesced. And it's too soon to say how many people have marched, or in how many places, even in how many countries. Too soon to say if the changes that seem possible today will manifest. But suddenly, uprising, revolution, transformation. It has been bizarrely terrible, but also somehow helpful that the police, accused of brutality, have responded with brutality. Anyone who wants to claim that police brutality is isolated or minimal has an increasingly hard time making that argument. Uprising, revolution, transformation. Also within the last week, terrifyingly, Trump seemed poised finally to ask the military to invade our own country and to attack the citizenry. Authoritarianism at last laid bare. And so far, the military has said no. Military leaders have affirmed their commitment to our Constitution and to protecting our civil liberties rather than violating them. So it was this week, at long last, for me, that I finally realized that what we're living through isn't some temporary unpleasantness that will eventually be over. This is our lives now. Whatever happens in the next election, we will be working to dismantle white supremacy for years, for decades, for the rest of our lives. Trump didn't create white supremacy, he revealed it to those of us who were too privileged to see. There is no going back because the only people who want to go back are racists and Nazis. I was happier when Obama was president because I was ignorant. And that's not okay. And there's no going back to before the pandemic either. We will, I hope, get over COVID-19, but we will always know how dangerous crowds are and how viruses travel and that wearing a mask is helpful. Will we go back to shaking hands after coronavirus? Will we hold hands while we sing? Time will tell. I've been calling this an age of overwhelm from my privileged position. And what I finally see is that this is actually an age of transformation. We're changing. The world is changing, thank God, finally and at last. That's why we're so tired. Change is exhausting. We are taking in and letting go all of the time. As Reverend Karen Hutt invited us earlier, imagine the creation of a spiritual, human, life-centered, life-giving hope that's rooted in the reality of the world we have now, not the one we dream of. Time, for so many of us who have had our head in the clouds, living in our privilege, to face the reality of the world we have now. And from that place, to work for change. Amen to that. Please join in singing. Heaven knows where we are going. Heaven knows how we will get there. It is hard, we know, and the road is indeed muddy and rough, but we are together. We are joyful, and each of us is loved. Go in peace, go with love. There is no coffee hour today. Our congregational meeting will start in just a few minutes. Members have the meeting information in an email. You received a reminder email Friday afternoon. You are invited to close our time together by singing the well.